Thank you very much, and I have to admit that I become a bit sentimental coming back to Lund and to meet with students again. And this environment is fantastic, as our guests have already noticed. It's a privilege to have served on the board of Lund University, and it's a privilege to be invited to come again. So, ladies and gentlemen, dear students, is the world becoming a better place? That's one of the questions being asked during all the seminars at Lund University celebrating its 350th anniversary. So let me first say warm congratulations, and let me assure you that I'm always very happy to be back here. And I'm sure that this question, is the world becoming a better place, has been discussed by generations of students while walking the streets and parks of Lund. And throughout history, the answer has been both yes and no. Just like in 2017, rapid progress has gone hand in hand with setbacks. Today we are faced with several protracted conflicts, the continued scourge of terrorism, systematic sexual and gender-based violence, and the largest refugee crisis in modern history. It is clear that the international system has failed in its core task of ensuring peace and security for all. And the world needs to change its approach. Adhering to the status quo is not an option. In order to break the status quo and make the world a better place, we need gender equality. The fantastic phrase, "women's rights are human rights," must become the spine of all our political work. I am the foreign minister of the world's first officially feminist government, consisting of 12 men and 12 women. And since my government assumed office 2 years ago, I have pursued a feminist foreign policy. And in this way, we are trying to shift our focus from response to prevention, and we are changing our approach from reactive to proactive. And prevention can never be successful without a proper analysis of how situations and developments affect men, women, boys and girls differently. So, friends, allow me to continue by describing what our feminist foreign policy is, how we apply it, and what difference it has made so far. The concluding section will provide some very practical examples of how we use diplomacy as a tool for peace and gender equality. So when describing a feminist foreign policy, it is useful to start with the three fundamental R's: rights, representation, and resources. Because rights are at the core of our policy. As I said, human rights are also women's rights. And the fact that such a simple statement still causes so much controversy is just one more proof of how much a feminist foreign policy is needed. When it comes to the second R, representation, we start by asking a simple question: where are the women? Who makes decisions? Whether in foreign or domestic policy or economic decision-making, we see that women are chronically underrepresented in positions of influence. Resources refer to the need to apply a gender perspective, also when distributing aid or other resources. If you want to understand why women and men are treated differently worldwide, you should, as the saying goes, follow the money. Are women in charge of their own economic situation and their own resources? For example, in 2014, humanitarian funding for UN-wide crisis response totaled more than $9 billion, but only 4% of projects were gender-specific, and this needs to change. The three R's that symbolize or are the tools and the approach of a feminist foreign policy are anchored in the fourth one, reality. Reality is about getting facts and analysis right from the outset. what does the situation on the ground look like if we include 100% of the population? And in this time of misinformation and campaigns and alternative facts, so the need to base policies on knowledge and experience is perhaps greater than ever. The second question that must be asked is how the feminist foreign policy is applied. In practice, our feminist foreign policy means that we apply a systematic gender perspective in everything we do. We use our foreign policy tools to promote gender equality, and we use gender equality to advance our foreign policy objectives. So how do we do it within the Swedish Foreign Service? Well, let me highlight four operational ingredients. The first is about leadership. And I tried to show leadership when I took office in October 2014 and proclaimed a feminist foreign policy. That creates expectations, of course, and also accountability. This is, of course, a necessary condition, but it is not enough. Leadership is needed at all levels at the ministry. And I have made it crystal clear to all heads of department that they are responsible for the gender mainstreaming of their own and their staff's work and workplace. The second element is ownership. 2 months after the launch of a feminist foreign policy, we sent a letter to all parts of the foreign service, meaning all embassies and our representation, outlining our strategic thinking and inviting everyone from Copenhagen to Kabul to get back to us with their reflection and input. And this was a key step, a policy that had been introduced top down, now became homegrown. And this also spurred colleagues from different policy areas and geographical locations to discuss gender equality and also increase their understanding of possibilities for action. And the reports from these discussions, I think, gave us a solid base as we continued to develop and operationalize our policy. And it is essential for all parts of my organization to have a feeling of ownership in this new policy, such as the feminist foreign policy, to continue over time. And I must say it was impressive the way the embassies reported back home to headquarters, putting those glasses on, the gender lenses on, and saying, well, suddenly we started to ask, but how many girls are married before the age of 18? And how does that affect the economic development in a certain country? Or suddenly we discovered this or that phenomenon in society in a way that we have never really looked at before. The third element after leadership and ownership is really direction. And the suggestions from colleagues all over the world were channeled into our first action plan. And that was launched in November 2015. And that action plan outlined our work, outlining the hows and whos and whats. And it includes 6 long-term goals and yearly focus areas reflecting the most pressing challenges. And the action plan has now been incorporated into the Foreign Service's operational plan. And that means that work on gender mainstreaming is followed up and measured in our regular processes within all the ministry's activities. And as you know, this is crucial to keep momentum in any large bureaucracy. The yearly process enables us to learn and benefit from conclusions and new data. And if you want to have a look at the action plan, you can access it on the website of the Swedish government. The fourth element is support. If gender mainstreaming is everyone's responsibility, a focal point function is also necessary. And we therefore have an ambassador for gender equality who is also the coordinator of the feminist foreign policy. And the ambassador and her team, they coordinate the development and follow up of the action plan. They develop support material, including e-learning. And they collect and disseminate good practices, connect across policy areas, and contribute to developing policy, communication, and incentive structures as well. For instance, we have now an award, a regional diploma to an embassy that has implemented the policy in a particularly outstanding way. So we try to encourage those that really are on the front line. Moreover, the ambassador also has a specific point of contact among the advisors in my office in order to facilitate all important procedures. So, talking about methods and ways of implementation is one thing. The main question, and the third question here, is what difference a feminist foreign policy has made so far. And of course, it is not a very long time that we've had. It's just a little more than over 2 years to implement something that is a complete change of approach, I would say. But the overall result has been a cultural shift within our foreign service as an organization. And I am proud to say that it has generated also important outcomes. Our efforts have contributed to some 20 countries drawing up laws and proposals to strengthen gender equality, to hundreds of thousands of women and girls avoiding unsafe abortions and unwanted pregnancies, and to some 90 local communities abandoning the practice of female genital mutilation. On rights, we are proud that our chairmanship to the Call to Action initiative has helped to increase the number of partners. So we are now 66 states and organizations having made more than 265 commitments to prevent and respond to gender-based violence in emergencies. And of course, this is important in particular now that we have such flows of migrants and refugees. Regarding representation, we have promoted women as actors in peacemaking through the provision of resources, connections, capacity building, and advisory support from our Swedish network of women mediators. And when it comes to resources, the Swedish government is providing substantive support to promote gender equality and women's and girls' full enjoyment of human rights. As an example, a gender equality perspective should be integrated in all assistance provided by the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency, SIDA. So, after this overview of our feminist foreign policy, I would like to describe more specifically how we are strengthening Sweden's capacity to contribute to inclusive and sustainable peace processes. First of all, a support function for dialogue and peace processes has been established at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs in Stockholm. Moreover, a handful of embassies in conflict areas will receive extra support. And the aim is, of course, to strengthen Sweden's involvement throughout the conflict cycle and more effectively address the root causes fueling conflicts. The modern mediation, and I'm sure you will hear more from the other panelists here also, the modern mediation landscape is multidimensional. We are witnessing a proliferation of actors engaged in inter- and intrastate conflicts. So the nature of war has very much changed. And this affects both when and how Sweden could and should contribute to peace processes. The classic solo mediator is less frequently called upon. What we see more often today are different forms of partnership with other peacekeeping actors, such as the UN, the European Union, the African Union, OECD, the Red Cross, and not least the local organizations. And in this way, political, personal, or financial aid is provided. We also need to think creatively about the role of mediator and all the different instruments available. And here are some current examples of available Swedish instruments. We have embassies and development assistance in 13 conflict-affected countries, including Colombia, Afghanistan, and Somalia. We have special envoys for peace efforts in the Great Lakes region, the Horn of Africa, and Syria. We have conflict secured all of our development assistance with a focus on peace building. And a new development strategy for peaceful and inclusive societies is expected to be complete by this summer. And the strategy builds on Sustainable Development Goal 16 and has a special focus on conflict prevention, women, peace and security, as well as rapid support for peace processes. I have taken the initiative to form a Swedish female mediation network, and the network consists of, so far, 9 experienced women ready to promote inclusive peace processes and also assist local women peace builders. The mediation network has, for example, contributed to peace efforts in Syria, Burundi, Afghanistan, and Somalia. And in Afghanistan, a dialogue and mediation training with local Afghan women peace builders have been particularly successful. And the Swedish network is a component of a Nordic mediation network. And we are now approached by also the African Union, for example, saying that it should also be completed with women from that part of the world. There is an image of Sweden since a long time back as an honest, serious and long-term partner. And that enables us to provide good offices and also to use Sweden as a platform for talks between different parties. And this is important knowledge also from some of the ongoing peace processes, like in Colombia, that an important element to be able to conduct those peace negotiations as it was in Cuba over the years. They lost some of the anchoring within Colombia, and that was a setback, but it was also important to be able to take it somewhere else. There was less tension and you didn't have to create special solutions for having peace negotiations in your own country. We have also a partnership with a series of mediation organizations, such as Interpeace, Intermediate, the Center for Humanitarian Dialogue, the European Institute of Peace, Conciliation Resources, and Crisis Management Initiative that is based in Finland. Swedish organizations, such as the Dag Hammarskjöld Foundation and also SIPRI, the Swedish International Peace Research Institute, often provide unique input and knowledge of individual peace efforts. We should also, well, as I said, we should recognize the lessons learned from peace processes in Colombia, the Philippines, Somalia, and Liberia, because they are central also to our efforts. Because we know that transparency is a prerequisite for dealing with the causes of conflict and for peace to last. A successful peace process is not only a question of a ceasefire or a formal agreement between the warring parties. It is also about justice, reconciliation, reconstruction, education, access to health, political access and distribution of resources. And a sustainable peace process creates the conditions for stable and legally secure institutions that promote social, economic and political development for all. Because the experience over time through history has been that even if there is peace, there is rarely peace for women. Sexual violence continues or is even exacerbated, with new elements to it introduced. And women do not enjoy peace in the same way. Within the framework of our feminist foreign policy, we will therefore also further develop support for women's meaningful participation in peace efforts before, during, and after conflicts. And for me, it is obvious that women must be included equally in all parts of society. When research so clearly shows that gender-equal societies are also less likely to end up in conflict, It is no longer possible to justify why half the population should be excluded from discussions about their own future. And consistently in the Security Council, since we are now a member of the Security Council, we have to ask, where are the women? Are they in the texts of everything from press statements to resolutions? Are they there as peacekeepers on the ground? Are they there included in any peace agreements? And we will also strengthen our ability to build peace from below. Formal peace processes that exclude either the victims of the conflict or local peace builders have limited opportunities to be sustained over time. By linking processes at local, national, and international level, one can lay the foundation for legitimate agreement that takes the root causes of conflict into account. So inclusive peace process is therefore not only an issue of rights, it is also smart policy. So friends, finally, when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted, there were only two women on the Human Rights Commission responsible for drafting the declaration. Many of you know the first one, Eleanor Roosevelt. The other one was Hansa Mehta, an Indian writer and independence activist. When the commission proposed the phrase, "all men are brothers," Hansa Mehta objected. She noted that this could be interpreted in some countries as an opportunity to exclude women. Hansa's insistence on incorporating an expression that fully recognized the equality of women and men resulted in the text finally adopted for Article 1 that reads, "All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights." Each of you, individually and you collectively, have a sphere of influence that is within your control at a personal level, in your interaction with others, and in organizations where you might be active. Bringing women into decision-making, applying gender analysis, calling for and collecting gender disaggregated data, these things can be done everywhere, at universities and at foreign ministries. In different ways, we can raise our voices and play a part. Sometimes it takes 100 years and millions of men and women to change the course of history. Sometimes it takes one person and one moment. Hansa Mehta was just one woman, but she had a seat at the table, and her actions ensured that the Declaration on Human Rights became truly universal. And when I look at you, I see a room full of sisters and brothers to Hansa Mehta. And the time, I think, has come for gender equality. Thank you for listening, and thank you for everything you are doing.